Okay, so welcome back everyone to our final practical session. In the session, our main idea would be to go through basic workflow, how we usually work with the protein systems, and starting from that PDB structure, which usually almost the same as you could download from the PDB file. Could make a protein system and then convert it, then make a normal classical MDE equilibration and then convert it to QMMM and calculate some properties for that. So let's, I will go, yes, also in that session we will go through the how you can set up the non-standard CP2K parameters, the one which, for example, Holly. Holly told you about in a previous session, yeah, like using DFTD3 corrections, using non-standard basis set and plane wave cutoffs. So I will show you, I will give you an idea how it should be done on the example of a calculation of absorption spectra for the EGFP protein. Okay, so let's just go through the basic workflow, which you usually, which one usually apply when you're doing some QMMM simulations. So in reality, what you do, you first start with your some input structure, usually it's crystallographic structure, sometimes it's NMR structure, sometimes it's cryo-EM structure, but whatever. So you start from some coordinates, and then what you should do, usually it's from PDB, from PDB data bank, or if it's membrane, you build membrane yourself, for example, but first, what you should do, you should treat your PDB file. So you should add any missing residues. You should check the protonation states of your histidines, for example. You should then prepare your define a box size in which you want to solvate this here, or how you want to calculate this. Then you need to basically do PDB to GMX to generate ROM topology. So of course you need for any non-standard residue you will need parameters, yeah, like for chromophore in that case you need parameters because it's non-standard residue. So and after that you basically will get a working system, yeah. But I suppose that almost all of you are well know what GROMX it is, so you can go through these steps yourself, and or you are going through that in your usual life. And on the next stage, you perform your classical MD simulations. So you do first energy minimization, then you do equilibration, then you do usually production run. That's how usually the workflow for MD, for classical MD is working. And then you can do whatever you want. So then you can do FEP calculation or replica exchange or whatever to search conformations. Okay, but then how then to switch to QMMM? You basically need to do what we already done the previous day. So you, in your index file, you need to define the group which will be your QM atoms. Then you need to put that MDB parameters which I showed you already yesterday. Or there is another option which we'll talk about today. You can also provide an external CP2K input instead of the automatically generated one. And then you can use whatever parameters of CP2K you want. So, and with that, you can perform QMMM calculations, so like geometry optimizations, like calculation spectra, doing QMMM molecular dynamics, like Born-Oppenheimer dynamics in that case, and calculating some properties like charges, absorption spectra, and so on. Okay, so here today we'll work with a system called EGFP. So what is EGFP? It stands for enhanced green fluorescent protein. So it's a mutant of the wild type green fluorescent protein, which have several, like order or so higher fluorescence intensity. It's one of the first mutants which have been made for that. And usually if you're talking today about the some GFP labeled proteins in the biology, usually they are labeled with that EGFP instead of wild type GFP. But nevertheless, so as a crystal structure that has been solved already a long time ago, and it is available in several variants in the PDB data bank. I have to just one of them, the most complete one. And inside that protein, there is no standard residue called chromophore, which can absorb light and then fluoresce. Yeah, with very distinct green fluorescence. So this residue, yeah, called chromophore, and this is a it's formed by after catalytic reaction between glycine, tyrosine, and in that case, I think threonine. So it's some after catalytic reaction, but yeah, you can read about that, how it works, but it's not so easy. Okay, but anyway, this non-standard residue can absorb light. And what we want to do in our final exercise, we want to calculate the absorption spectra of that protein in solution using the DFT. But first we need to make a suitable model for that. So, and that's why I suggest you to start with exercise five, steps from 1 to 5. So in steps 1 to 5, you will perform basically the first build up of your system from the PDB file, and then you will do the molecular mechanical equilibration of that. So first you will do energy minimization with classical force field, and then you do NVT run, 1 nanosecond only, but it should be okay for that system. And yeah, so please do that. And once you've done that, please raise your hand. Once you submit the second one, the second, once you submit the NVT, molecular dynamical trajectory. Because it will take some time for it to calculate. Why does this happen? Because probably you have incorrect charges for the chromophore, for example, in that case, because charges of the chromophore could be parameterized such they are non-zero in total of the chromophore atoms. So usually you, when you parameterize some amino acid residues, you have zero or plus one or minus one charge for the whole residue, and that is your constraint. Yeah, but in that kind of system, it depends how you parameterize that non-standard residue. So, for example, this chromophore which I showed in the balls here, it is a minus one charge. But I think in the force field that some of that charges on that atoms will be non minus one. This could be, but it's very rare. But it depends. If you have a very small deviation from the charge, then it's probably just the rounding errors of your scripts with which you convert. But if it's not, then it is probably that you are missing some parameters for some residues in another force field. And what happens that basically this, for example, zero, it set up automatically zero charge on that kind of non-standard residues, and that's why you see images just. Yes, usually you need to check your charges in the MD parameters so that they will be integer, because you don't have, you cannot have non-integer charge in classical MD. Usually it is means that something went wrong. In QMMM, however, you can see that. You could see that, as you saw yesterday. Just checking that we don't expect that minimization converge just complete 1,000 steps. Yes, it should not converge. We don't need, you don't need usually to wait for convergence. Minimization in case of classical MD, well, its main idea is that your bonds, angles, and dihedrals will be more or less the in the right, in the correct average value. You'll have more correct average value so that once the MD will start, they will not, it will not break your system into the parts. Sometimes it also happens when you use constraints for production run. If you use it with constraints, then usually if you do not do minimization beforehand, your constraints will start complaining and it will blow up your system. So minimization needed just for so that your starting structure for MD will be more or less in the right, in a, with the correct bonds lengths and angles. Yes. So, for example, that's why in that also in that exercise, you starting your MD equilibration with optimization trajectory. So you're starting with the last frame of optimization. So basically that's the idea, that you first optimize, then you do a calibration and rerun, and then you do production and rerun. Why do we set option during salutation shell 10? Okay, it's one of the options how you can fill up your system. So if you are familiar with Gromax GMX salvate tool, so shell 10 means that the Gromax will salvate the system such there will be at least 10, oh, not at least, but how it's called. So it will try to salvate your system, which is protein in that case, with a range of 10 nanometers. But if the 10 nanometers will go over the box, of course, size, because our box here is 10 nanometers by 10 nanometers by 10 nanometers, then it will cut it. So it's just a way how you can salvage the whole box. That's how I usually do it. There is a hundreds of ways how you can do it. But with that shell option is probably the easiest way how you can. So it's basically the radius in which it will add a solvent around your system, but it is not bigger than your box size. Yes. And no, it's not specific, it's just how I am usually doing, but you can do it whatever you want. You can do it even in VMD. You can salvate and generate ions in VMD, and then just pass it to the Gromax PDB to GMX. Yes, that system, but just how the Gromax works. Okay, I see that many people already managed to do so. So let's continue. I will put back your hands. Okay, so now we will switch our system to QMMM. Once equilibration for you is finished, I will check quick. Okay, I see that some people are still running. Okay, but nevertheless, wait until your job calibration run classical will finish and then continue. But so for the MTP parameters, we use the following parameters. For initial QMMM equilibration again run, we will do first a short QMMM equilibration again. Our QM group will be QM atoms, but in that case, you will need to generate index file yourself. Our QM group will be that atoms which I highlighted here. So it is that one which evolves here. So it's chromophore basically atoms. It's not a big system, but still. The charge of that system, as I already told, is -1. So this anion. And the multiplicity is again 1. So you can look into that parameters in the MDP file, in the respect MDP file. But first, let's start doing steps 6 to 9. In the step number 6, I suppose you will need to generate index file. Yes. And this is how you define that. You also can check yourself if you render the conf.grow file that these atoms are actually chromophore atoms. Note that they may be, they may have index ±1 depending on the starting index of the first atom. Yeah, in your particular program, for example, PyMOL, I don't remember. In VMD, they will have index -1 because VMD starts indexes from 0. Gromax starts indexes from 1. So, but you can render them in VMD or PyMOL and basically check that indeed these atoms, which you are set as a QM atoms in the make and NDX utility, is that atoms which I showed you. I had to rename my QM atoms group in index. Yeah, the group you will create will be called A, underscore and number range of atoms. Then you need to rename it to QM atoms. That's what the second line is doing. Yeah, when you do name 18 QM atoms, you rename it to QM atoms. Or you can leave it like that and then put that index name into the MDP file. It's up to you. It's up to you. What is also important here? I'm getting 19 atoms in my index. Let me check. I guess it should be, yeah. 18. Yeah, correct. It's 18 atoms. But do not forget to rename it to QM atoms. So idea is that this charge, the Gromox warn you that after the transfer in topology to the from purely classical MM to QMM, you don't have a zero charge in the total system. Total system is already not have says no zero charge now. Why? Because the QM atom sum of charges of the QM atom is not classical charges on the QM atoms is not necessarily should be the same as your QM charge, that minus one. For example, in that case, it is something like minus 75 or minus 74 and 7. And that's why it warns you that you have excess 0.25.3 charge. How it suggests usually how it should be done, how it dealt with. Usually it is suggested that this excess charge and also Gromox prints on the next line that you have, you consider to redistribute that excess charge onto the nearby MM atoms. And that's actually what you need to do. So basically you can modify the charge of that nearby atoms here and there such that they will be increased or decreased by the number so that the total charge of the system will be again zero. You can do that, but in reality it is not so important because the charge is really small. And usually no one cares about that. But sometimes it can be important. For example, if you do a membrane system in the membrane. So that's why the Gromox just suggests you how much excess charge you have and how you should be, but how you should redistribute it, it's up to you. You can even leave it like that. Another problem is that there is no unique solution how you should redistribute that. So everyone is doing it up like how they want mostly. Yes. That's why it warns you. But for example, if your total charge of your QM atoms was zero, like yesterday in Steelman case, yeah, Steelman's neutral molecule, and both all atoms have zero, sum of classical charges on it was zero, then it will be zero excess charge, of course. Yeah, but it usually happens in the protein systems when you break your bonds, and that then your total charge will be not zero. Okay, so let's continue. So as an outcome of your QMD equilibration, I should have something like that. So this is just a render of the trajectory over 100 femtoseconds. Yeah, this is the temperature. So it's not really well equilibrated, so maybe we need to equilibrate more, but we don't have much time to do that today. But it will equilibrate like in several picoseconds, for sure. Okay, let's finish with this. Seems like it's going to run like 30 minutes. Who is going to run 30 minutes? I'm sorry. This one? No, it should not. If it tries to run for 30 minutes, then spec, but it QMMM spec is the next steps. Yeah, you're already doing the exercise 6. yes, it will run approximately that. So exercise 6, now we want to modify, we want to use non-standard in our system, we want to calculate spectra of that system, which you just equilibrated. And we want to, how we want to do it, we want to use PDEFT. And to do that, you should modify CP2K input. So how it should be done in general, instead of that, you use a QMMM method called input. And then you need to provide the additional string, which is called QMMM QM input file. And it should be a name of the CP2K input file in the same directory as the GPRS will be. So in that case, you can provide whatever options you want in that file. Just remember that this file should still be should still represent the same system. So it's better to use a reference CP2K input generated by the interface and modify it and then provide here because then you will have no problem with the system. Okay, so So this is our objective. So now we want to calculate absorption spectra. How we want to do this? We will do the molecular dynamics trajectory, and along that trajectory, on each step, we will calculate also excitation energies using TDDFT, and then we convolve that excitation energies into spectra. So how you should do this? Please do the steps 1 to 5 of the exercise 6. So here it is a simple, simplest case how you modify your input file. You basically copy already the input file which has been generated in the previous calibration run with PDB also, and then you modify whatever you want in it. So you can also change here basis set. You can also change here cutoffs. You can also change here. You can also add here dispersion corrections if you want. You can also even change here to the bit relief if you want. So whatever you want to do, you can do like that. But here we just add a property section. We add a property section to calculate which informs the speed of k on each during the after the calculation of the force to also perform TDFT calculation for 5 states, excited states with my e to the power of minus 3 convergence of in electron volts of the excitation energies. It is also easy to run simulation from excited state of the molecule in the QM part against dynamics motion. With that kind of things, yes, you can. But you should be warned, yes, you can. But for now, interface does not support surface hopping dynamics of all, so you cannot deactivate. So you will be stuck on one state always. But in practice with that, yes, using non-standard parameters, you also can calculate the gradient of the excited state, if you know how to do it in CPK for TDDFT. And then you can perform dynamics on that excited state with using that non-standard input and perform optimization of that excited state. And so on, calculate the fluorescence, for example, if you want. Okay, please, once you will run this spec, that spectra calculation will take quite some time, over 20 minutes, as already have been noted by the people. Probably we can discuss a bit further what will happen. And next, it seems like you are reading it wrong because, it's an error, yeah. I saw your thing. Yeah, of course, here, because you are providing external input, the Gromox does not know that your QM system has a minus one charge. So how you can solve that, you need to add this, again, into the MDP file, this QM charge equal to minus one option into the MDP file, and then it should be correct. I need to think about how to fix this. Probably it should not print at all that warning if you're providing external input, because then it's up to you how you do this. indeed. Sorry for that. Actually, I need to write it down because in that case, indeed, it's the output is a bit confusing. That needs to be fixed in the future versions. Yes. Why is this? Yes, probably just never mind about this. This is just an error, not an error, but an inconsistency in the for now because it's alpha version. If you provide your own output file or input file, then the Gromox basically should not complain about this kind of stuff. Because already it's up to you. It doesn't know what is the charge of your current system. You will still have a time to finish whatever you want. Here I just want you to show what we're gonna do next after how we convolve the actual spectra from our simulations. So this is how your MDP file looks like. So here you add this external input file. and how we want to calculate the absorption spectra of your system in the following way. So if you do LS on that output file, you can search for it and find that kind of things, that kind of tables after each at each step, after each calculation of energy. So this is a result of the TDDC calculation. Basically, this is states number, excited state number. So we request five states, so there is five states. This is excitation energies of that in electron volts, and this is a transition dipole from the ground state, and this is a calculated oscillator strength, which is just a function of excitation energy and transition dipole moment. And states, I don't know, typically several states, like 5 to 10 will be fine. Yeah, I mean, the energy of individual states is not dependent on how much states you requested. It's just the completeness of spectra will be different. Okay, so and oscillator strengths, and using that two parameters, this one, this, and this, you can convolve the absorption spectra. Yeah, okay. Here, how we will do that. First, we will grab out of this output file the column number 1, 2, 3, and 7. Yeah, so column 3 and 7. Okay, using awk tool. It's a bit of the bash scripting, so everyone who knows what it is probably already understand what it is doing. And we'll create this. You create the file excitations, which will contain all just only these and these parts of your output file. Oops, is this missing something? Yeah, so do basically step 7. I think this is excitation generation. Yes. And after you've done that, it's pretty easy. I mean, it's just one option. So if you look into that excitation file, there will be a two columns. First is excitation energy, second is oscillator strength, grabbed from that output file. So first one, yeah, is excitation energy in electron volts. Second, it's oscillator strength in some arbitrary units. It's actually unitless, but yeah. Okay, so now how we will deal with that? So how we'll convolve the spectra? We will use Gaussian functions. So we'll basically, in each point of that at that energy, we'll place a Gaussian function with the heights equal to the oscillator strengths, and with the energy equal to this one, and with sigma, it is some parameter, it's just a half width of your Gaussian, it will be 0.1 electron volt. Why? Because typically the TDDFT gives you 0.1 to 0.3 EV error. And yeah, 0.1 is just a less meaningful number, the meaningful number for that. So yeah, so here it is your, what we can do. So here it is UBF, so yes. E is your final energy which you want to convolve. So this is just a parameter, as it's just like X. And we want to convolve that I function. So which is done in step 8. So you can you need to modulo at Cray Python to use the Python actually on the Archer. So do not forget to do that. And then you can convolve your spectra. So first parameter is your name of your file with excitation. Second is second parameter is, I will show it properly here. So first parameter is a file with excitations, which you just generated. Second is a sigma in electron volts, 0.1. And then there is minimum and maximum energies in electron volts between which you want to calculate the spectra. So basically the boundaries of the spectra. So after doing this, it will be generated as spec.xvg file. Which you still can open with any software you want. I mean, in a way, you don't need necessary to wait until the QMMM spec run will finish. So after 10 minutes, there will already like 20 to 30 frames, which from which you can calculate some spectra. But yeah, basically you can do it at any point. But what is very important that if you look into the results, that after approximately 100 femtoseconds, which I generated like yesterday or several days ago, in my case, in your case, it might be different, but the spectra looks like that. So you see that there is really two bumps. However, if you extend your sampling and you increase and you calculate the spectra over 3,000 frames, yeah, so after the 3 picosecond simulation, it will stabilize and it will be always like that. So in reality, this is like a one huge bump and a small shoulder on the side due to the higher excited states. So basically, this is a swan peak, usually main peak, and this is a side peak of from S2 from the higher excited state. Also, it should be noted that this peak is not very well reproduced the experimental peak, but this is mostly a problem of the DDFT. For really reproducing exactly the experimental peak, usually, well, if you are doing this VCDFT, you need to shift it. So you basically need to apply. Now you need to check what is the experimental peak here, and you need to apply that shift to get it correct. However, and the EFT is generally not so suitable to reproduce, I mean, from the scratch, the exact spectra. There is much more elaborated methods to do so. So, but you, what you can do, the shape of the spectra, you can reproduce very well the shape of the spectra, and you can very well reproduce the, for example, with the DFT, you quite well could reproduce the, what's called Stokes shift. So the, basically the difference between excitation and absorption of the emission spectrum. Okay, so I think for today this kind of tutorial is finished. So what I want to kind of inform you that we have already Colin noticed a best practice guide for that non-standard parameters for all the C2K parameters relevant to the biological QMMM. So the second one, there is there was already a workshop which you can about the usage of the QMMM in real for a real scientist, for a real, from a real scientist. Yeah, there was a series of webinars which you can pick up in the which are available through the YouTube channel, so you can see how the people are using the QMMM in their real job and the examples of that. Also, UCP2K, for example. There's a couple of people who are using it, was here giving the talks. And what I want to you also kind of promote is Bioxel YouTube channel, where you can find a lot of interesting stuff and a lot of interesting webinars regarding the modeling of biological systems, not with QMMM, but with anything, yeah? Not only with QMMM, but with many of other stuff. So, yeah. From that, I think we are kind of finished. Yeah, so any questions? Yes, so the question is, what is the minimum solution time for an accurate spectra calculation? How it depends a lot on the system. I can say yes, so how I suggest you to do it. So first of all, you will need to do a long equilibration run with classical MM. So basically do like tens of nanoseconds here to be sure that your system is equilibrated. Then from that 10 nanosecond, like let's say 10 to 100 nanosecond trajectory, yeah. Then from that trajectory, I would suggest you to pick up frames each several nanoseconds. And from that frames start a QMMM trajectory like we done today. And do that trajectory for several hundred of femtoseconds. And gather the spectra from them, and then convolve the spectra over your system. So from starting from several MM structures, from which you do the QMMM simulations and from which you convolve the final spectrum. So basically put everything into one slide. Why you need a long MD equilibration? Because typically your protein could live in several conformations, and transfer time between this transition time between these conformations could be in nanoseconds or even 100 nanoseconds time scale, and you never know. And they could have a bit different spectra. So that's why you need a long classical MD equilibration sampling. Yeah, and from that sampling, you then pick up frames from which you start QMMM simulation and calculate spectra. Yes, so in reality, you need to have a good sampling. Yes.